section number 20. And I didn't know if I was going to get through preaching this morning or not. I think it was just hunger pains, but I hadn't eaten any breakfast. I ate a few strawberries. I've been trying to do the intermittent fasting where I only eat between 11 in the day and 6 or 7, and then 18 hours without eating. You say, why are you doing that, preacher? Well, my back, my knees, I could go on. But anyway, but this morning I found out something that ain't going to work on Sunday. I'm going to have to eat something before I try to preach on Sunday morning, amen. So we'll have to change the schedule around a little bit on Sunday, amen. I didn't know what was going on. I felt like I'd done 100 sit-ups when I got through preaching this morning. And I appreciate you praying for us, and appreciate the Lord. He's good to us. Amen. I'm just going to read one verse of Scripture, and then we're going to be preaching in the verses surrounding it tonight. If you're able, stand in reverence to the Word of God with me tonight. And I want to read one verse. It's in verse number 12. I'm going to read verse 13 as well. In verse number 12 of 2 Chronicles chapter number 20, the Bible said, O our God, wilt thou not judge them? And this was for them, and this text is the Ammonites, you find out, and the children of Moab, and the children of Ammon, you find that in verse number 1. Wilt thou not judge them? Now look at this statement. For we have no might against this great company that cometh against us, neither know we what to do. But our eyes are upon thee. The subject tonight is when we have no might, and we don't know what to do. I pinned that title down this afternoon. I was looking at the scripture earlier this week, and I don't know why, but immediately I thought of St. Jude. I thought of the parents carrying their babies in there. That would be a place where you build no mind. Neither would you know what to do. I thought of the earthquake in Turkey. The death count now is 37,000 plus. Those people, they're digging out bodies with a big truck hole. But I tell you this, I don't say it rejoicingly. It's going to get worse. God, I believe, is trying his best to get people to wake up. I mean, and realize this book is real. They said it was the greatest catastrophe in a century. Think about that. 100 years. I just know tonight that it's very possible that everybody in this building will find themselves somewhere along the way in a place where you have no might, and you don't know what to do. You can be seated. Let's pray together. Father, tonight, Sister Reese, I just like to stop and tell you, Lord, though you know it, though I tell you, I love you. I thank you, Lord, for your Bible, the Word of God that you left us. God, I pray tonight you'd make it real to us. And Lord, I know tonight there may be somebody that needs this right now, and there may be somebody, Lord, that needs to put this in the spiritual bank. Because our Father, before the week is over, before the month is over, before the year is over, they can find themselves in a place where they have no money. They don't know what to do. I pray, dear Father, tonight you clothe us in our calling and make the message a blessing to those that are here tonight. And God will give you glory. All of God's people said, amen. Let me just get right into the message tonight and ask the Lord to help us. Turn back over to the first part of the chapter, if you will, tonight. And let me show you some things here tonight that I think will be a blessing to you. There's something I'm looking for here that I just pinned down a while ago. Oh, I see what it is now. I understand now. Verse 20, look at chapter 20, rather, verse 1. And it came to pass after this also that the children of Moab and the children of Ammon and with them other besides the Ammonites came against Jehoshaphat to battle. I want to ask you a question tonight. How many of you realize we're in a spiritual warfare, a spiritual battle? We're not wrestling against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers, and spiritual wickedness in high places. The Word of God said, then there came some that told Jehoshaphat, saying, there cometh a great multitude against thee from beyond the sea on this side Syria, and behold, they be in Hazon Tamar, which is in Gedi. And Jehoshaphat feared. The first thing I want to mention in the message tonight, when we have no mind and we don't know what to do, we need to realize it's okay to fear. You say, well, Pastor, I don't know why you would make mention of that. I'll just tell you how God dealt in my heart. Go back with me, please, to 2 Chronicles chapter 17 for just a moment. This man, Jehoshaphat, in verse number 3, what we just read in your hearing, said, and Jehoshaphat feared. I want to show you what kind of man that he was. He's not a wicked man. He was God's man. The Word of God said in verse 1 of chapter 17, and Jehoshaphat, his son, reigned in his stead and strengthened himself against Israel. And he placed forces in all the fenced cities of Judah and set garrisons in the land of Judah and in the cities of Ephraim, which Asa, his father, had taken. And the Lord was with Jehoshaphat. Ain't that a good statement? Ain't it good to know God's with you? Amen. There was a time when America knew that God was with us. Amen. There's a time we looked to Him. And the Bible said here, the Lord was with Jehoshaphat because he walked in the first ways of his father David, and sought not to Balaam, but sought to the Lord God of his father, and walked in his commandments, and not after the doings of Israel. Therefore the Lord established the kingdom in his hand, and all Judah brought to Jehoshaphat presents, and he had riches and honor in abundance. The first point in the message tonight, I just trying to get across to you. I don't care who you are. I don't care how long you've been serving God. It's all right to fear. When you have no might and you have no idea what to do, it's all right to fear. Jehoshaphat was a good man. The Word of God said there that he walked in the ways of his father David. And David said, and over in Psalm chapter 56 and verse number 3, the man after God's own heart said, what time I'm afraid, I will trust in thee. I tell you, there's no need walking through this world just thinking you're big and you're bad and ain't nothing going to hurt you, ain't nothing going to crush you. Because I'm telling you, beloved, God said he knew that we were flesh, that we were frail, amen? And God is a merciful God. Yes, he is. But we'll face things in our life when we have no mind, neither knowing what to do. I face that in the ministry. Let me tell you something. No one can make people submit. No one can make people get right with each other. No one can make people love you. Amen. You can't do that. It takes God to do that. Amen.
And there's been times when I was afraid. God, what in the world is going on? And I had no money, and I did not know what to do. I faced that in my family as well. I hope that maybe you can get to heaven without facing that, but I got a good idea that all of us, at some point in our life, will find our place. You know, when your knees buckle and you can't even stand. Amen? But know this, God has a recipe. He says it's okay to fear. Number two, if when we have no hope and we don't know what to do, we need to request of the Lord in faith. Watch what the Bible said here in verse number 3. Jehoshaphat feared, but he didn't fear and run away from God. He feared and he ran to the Lord. Watch what he said. He feared and he set himself to seek the Lord and proclaimed a fast throughout all Judah. You know what Jehoshaphat did? He said, the Moabites, we can't handle them. The Ammonites, we can't handle them. I don't have enough might, and I don't know what to do. But I know one that can handle them. Amen? We need to seek the face of God. I don't know how in the world to handle the woke mob and how in the world to handle what's going on in this country. But I know the one who in a moment of time can turn it around. Say amen. God tonight wants us to request to talk to him. He said, and Judah, watch verse 4, they gathered themselves together to ask help of the Lord. I've been saying this for years. I'm ashamed to ask God to bless America. But I don't have a problem at all, Brother David, getting on my face and saying, God, help America! God help, it just come to my mind. I'm just going to go and say, God help that preacher in Atlanta that got up and said, GD America. God help a man that called himself a man of God and ain't got no more about him than that. Say amen. I'll say this to you tonight. Jehoshaphat, when he had no mind, he didn't know what to do. He went to the one that has the mind and knew what to do. And I thank God that he did. And the people followed him. He's their leader. But they gathered themselves together. They're fasting. And they're asking help of the Lord. Even out of all the cities of Judah, they came to seek the Lord. Ain't that good? Amen. When we have no might and we don't know what to do, we need to realize it's okay to fear. We need the request of the Lord, and we need to do it in faith. You remember over there in the book of James, the Bible says, if any of you lack wisdom, let him ask of God. Amen. Who giveth to all men liberally and upbraideth not. But the Word of God said, let him ask in faith. Nothing wavering. Amen. For he that wavereth is like the wave of the sea. Amen. But thank God tonight, listen, we can have faith that the God of heaven will hear. The God of heaven, the Bible said, if we ask anything according to his will, we know that he heareth us. The fourth, third thing tonight I want to mention. We need to realize it's okay to fear. We need to request of the Lord. We need to make that request in faith. But I want to say this tonight. This will help you tonight if you'll listen. When you have no mind, you don't know what to do. You don't know what's in front of you. How many knows what's behind you? How many can say God's been good back yonder? God's blessed our family. God's blessed our life. Amen. God's been good. Amen. You say, Pastor, where did you get that? Look at verse 5. And Jehoshaphat stood in the congregation of Judah and Jerusalem in the house of the Lord and before the new court. And he said, O Lord God of our fathers, art not thou the God of heaven? And rulest not thou over all the kingdoms of the heathen? And in thine hand is there not power and might, so that none is able to withstand thee? Art not thou our God? You see what he's doing? keep rehearsing, beloved. Listen, the good things of God. Amen. I'm telling you, beloved, sometimes when we're overwhelmed in our heart and in our spirit, we're prone to forget what God's already done. But here's the man that says, I'm just going to go back and I'm going to tell the people that he's still the same. He's the same God. Look what he done back yonder. And he's the same God. Watch it now. The Bible said here, gave us into the seed of Abraham, thy friend forever, and they dwelt therein, and have built thee a sanctuary therein for thy name, saying, if when evil cometh upon us, as the sword, judgment, pestilence, famine, and we stand before this house and in thy presence, for thy name is in this house, and cry unto thee in our affliction, then wilt thou hear and help. You remember that verse, 2 Chronicles chapter 7, verse 14. If my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face, turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven. I'll forgive their sin and I'll heal their land. That's what that's making reference to right there. God said, listen, you've got a place to come to where you can talk to me. Amen. And I'll hear and I'll help you. Tonight, we need to rehearse the blessings of God. We don't need to forget them. We need to go back, amen, in our heart and in our mind and think about how good God has been to us. The fourth thing I want to give you tonight is I study this out when we have no might and we don't know what to do. Realize it's okay to fear. We need to request of God and faith, and we need to rehearse the blessings of the Father. Just go over them. How many can say tonight, God's been good? I love that song. God's been good in my life. Amen. I believe Brother Craig and Miss Donna sang that when they come by one time. But I tell you tonight, it's true. God has been good to us tonight. The fourth thing I want to give you tonight, listen to me carefully, is you need to remember the secret of the faithful. You'll get this in just a moment. Watch this now. Look at verse 12. Oh, our God, wilt thou not judge them? For we have no might against this great company that cometh against us, neither know we what to do. Here's the secret of the faithful. But our eyes are upon thee. If you think about this tonight, I'm going to give you several examples in the Word of God. Jehoshaphat said, God, we don't know what to do. We don't have any strength. We don't have any might. But our eyes. I love that word in the Bible. I've told you that 100 times in 10 years. The word but. It makes all the difference in the world. The wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. But our eyes are upon thee. The secret of the faithful. I mentioned this morning in this morning's message that Paul, the apostle, was not looking at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. I mentioned this morning that Paul was a man that lived his life in victory. He said, thanks be to God, which always causes us to triumph through our Lord Jesus Christ. I want to give you another example, beloved, and that would be Joseph. Do you remember when Joseph's brethren came and they had to come down to Egypt and Joseph had corn because God had given Joseph the interpretation of Pharaoh's dream? There was going to be 7 years of plenty, and then there was going to be 7 years of famine like the world had never seen before. So Joseph told Pharaoh, said, what we need to do is during those 7 years of plenty, I think it was a fifth, but they put up corn during those 7 years of plenty, and they stored it back. And so what happened, there was Joseph's daddy and Joseph's brethren, and they were down there in Israel, and they didn't have anything to eat. And Joseph's daddy, beloved, listen, sent the boys down there to Egypt to get some corn. And I remember a couple of statements that Joseph made. He said, Pastor, how could Joseph, he's been sold into slavery, he was left in a pit, he was lied on and put in a prison, how in the world can a man like that keep going on when it was not in his mind, amen, to change anything? When he didn't know at times what to do, I'll tell you what he did. The secret is this. He kept his eyes on the Lord. Because even in the prison, everything that Joseph touched turned to gold. And the Bible said over and over, and the Lord was with Joseph, and the Lord was with Joseph, and the Lord was with Joseph. And it's the Lord that made the difference in Joseph's life and allowed him to say this. He said, it was not you to his brethren, but God. Amen. His brethren thought they were responsible for him being in Egypt. And he told them, later on in the 50th chapter there, he said, you meant it to me for evil, but God meant it for good. I'll tell you something right now. Joseph was looking beyond the stars. He was looking beyond his brethren. He was even looking beyond Egypt. And he knew the God of heaven. Amen. And the Bible said this, to save much people alive. That was the secret. He had his eye on somebody besides his brethren. It kept him from getting bitter. Beloved, let me tell you something about the trials of this life. They'll make you bitter as you let them. Did you hear what I just said? They'll make you bitter if you let them. But instead, Joseph kept his eyes on the Lord, and God made him a better man instead of a bitter man. Isn't that good? I believe that's what God wants to do in our lives. He's not trying to hurt us. He's trying to help us. And he's making us more like Jesus. I thought about Moses. Turn with me in your Bibles to Hebrews chapter 12 real quickly. Hebrews chapter 11. I don't know what I was thinking. But anyway, Hebrews chapter 11. I want to read a passage of Scripture there. I'm talking now about the secret of the faithful. How in the world did these people in the Word of God do what they did? When they had no might, and when they didn't know what to do, how did they do what they did? Look what the Word of God said. Hebrews chapter number 11, I'll start reading in verse 24. By faith Moses, when he was come of the years, he refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter, choosing rather to suffer affliction with the people of God than to enjoy the pleasures of sin for a season. You say, Pastor, why in the world would anybody choose to suffer rather than with the people of God? And by the way, beloved, you just better get ready, because before this thing's over, that might be a choice you and I need to make. Suffer. Did you see in the news where they're coming after the traditional Catholics? Honey, you say, well, that ain't going to bother us. We ain't far down the line. I can tell you that right now. Amen! Call parents terrorists. Now the Catholics are the problem. I tell you what's the problem. The old devil, amen, and a bunch of people don't know God. Taking our country in a direction away from God. Moses didn't take Israel away. He took them to the Lord. Watch this. The Bible said here, esteeming the reproach of Christ greater riches than the treasures in Egypt. For he had respect unto the recompense of reward. Verse 27, by faith he forsook Egypt, not fearing the wrath of the king, for he endured. Look at that statement now. I'm talking about the secret of the faithful. How did he endure? How did Moses accomplish what he did? How did Moses, beloved, when he had no might? How did Moses, when he didn't know what to do? How did he make it? I tell you, by seeing him who is invisible. You see that right there? You remember, I can't remember the story exactly. I think it was pertaining to Elijah. But Elijah 1, he said, how shall we do, Master, how shall we do? His servant. And it was either Elijah or Elijah said, Lord, open his eyes that he might see. And when God opened his eyes, he saw them chariots around. Amen. He saw that God had the situation under control. The secret of the faithful is they're able to see something besides what's going on right in front of them. Better worded would be this, someone besides what's going on right in front of them. Amen. The songwriter said victory in Jesus, and that's where our victory is tonight, in Jesus. You think about David down there in the valley with Goliath. I'm going to tell you something right now. He saw something besides a giant. Amen. And he went on out there and faced that giant. What do? When we have no mind and we don't know what to do, realize it's okay to fear. request of the Lord in faith. Rehearse the blessings of the Father. Remember the secret of the faithful. And then I want to give you this tonight in closing. Rejoice in the victory over the foe. You say, well, Pastor, the enemy just seems like he's winning. But see, you're looking at the short term. We need to look at the long term. Because there are going to be times when it looks like the enemy's winning. But I'm telling you tonight, I've done read the last chapter in the last book, and God's people, they win. Let me share this with you tonight. You come on over here in the chapter, in verse 15, he said, be not afraid nor dismayed by the reason of this great multitude, for the battle is not yours, but God's. Right there's what we need to realize, beloved. It's a spiritual warfare. Yes, it is. But the battle is the Lord's. Matter of fact, David said that when he went down in the valley with Goliath. He said, the battle is the Lord's. Look at this. Look at verse number 20. He said, believe in the Lord your God, so shall you be established. Believe his prophets, so shall you prosper. And the word of God, if you come on down through here, I want you to see this. How can we rejoice in the victory over the foe? That's what they're doing. Look in verse 21. And when he had consulted with the people, he appointed singers unto the Lord that should praise the beauty of holiness as they went out before the army, and to say, praise the Lord, for his mercy endureth forever. I'd say there's not too many armies, Brother Chris, that has a bunch of people singing out in front of them. Amen. But you say, that seems odd. No, that seems God to me. Amen. God just does things a little bit different than everybody else does. Amen. That's why the children of Israel could march around Jericho 6 times, keep your mouth shut, don't say nothing. But on that seventh day, on the seventh time around, he said, just shout. And the walls fell. God's people sometimes want to wait till the walls fall to shout. After we get the victory, we'll shout. God wants to shout on faith sometimes, say amen, knowing that he's got this. Watch this now. Come on down here, and the children of Ammon, Moab, in verse 23, stood up against the inhabitants of Mount Seir, utterly to slay and to destroy them. And when they had made an end of the inhabitants of Seir, everyone helped to destroy another. And when Judah came toward the watchtower in the wilderness, they looked unto the multitude, and behold, there were dead bodies fallen to the earth, and none escaped. Now remember, just a few verses before, Jehoshaphat saying, we have no mind, neither know we what to do. I believe they went to the right place, don't you? God told them what to do. Look in verse 25. And when Jehoshaphat and his people came to take away the spoil of them, they found among them in abundance both riches, dead bodies, precious jewels, which they stripped off for themselves. Look, I want you to notice the statement. More than they can carry away. Isn't that something tonight? Just a few verses before, they had no might, didn't know what to do, but God gave them the victory. And they were 3 days in gathering of the spoil. It was so much. And on the fourth day, they assembled themselves in the valley of Berekah. And there they blessed the Lord. Therefore, the name of the same place was called the Valley of Berekah unto this day. Look here. By the way, that word, if I'm saying it right, and I may not be, but that word Berekah means blessing. It was a valley of blessing. God had wrought the blessing. Then they returned every man to Judah and Jerusalem, and Jehoshaphat in the forefront of them, to go again to Jerusalem. What's those next 2 words? Ain't that good? Ain't that good? Brother Gary, been times when you thought, I'll never have my joy back. I'll never get through this. I'll never get over this. But I tell you, no matter what it is, keep your eyes on Jesus. I tell you what he'll do. He'll bring you through. Amen. Listen to me tonight. It'd be good if we could go around all the messes in life. But sometimes God just has to bring us through them. Amen. And I'll be honest with you. we're stronger because of it. Amen. And we'll be able to help somebody else along life's way. The Word of God said to go again to Jerusalem with joy, for the Lord had made them to rejoice over their enemies. And they came to Jerusalem with psalteries and harps and trumpets unto the house of the Lord. And the fear of God was on all the kingdoms of those countries when they had heard that the Lord fought against the enemies of Israel. You know what we need in America? We need an old-fashioned revival of the fear of God. We need people to be afraid to say what that preacher said in the pulpit. We need people to be afraid to steal, afraid to stab somebody, afraid, amen, to shoot a police officer, afraid to cuss a teacher in the school. Amen. We need an old-fashioned dose of the fear of God. And that's what came out of all of this. They saw, but listen, it wasn't just Jehoshaphat, and it wasn't just the people of Judah. All the countries round about heard. Amen. There was a time when America on the world stage, people heard. Israel even on the world stage. You think about, was it called the Seven-Day War? Is that what it was called? You think about that. Everybody says that was a miracle. I'll tell you what, it was God. Amen. God's not forsaking His people. And if you're saved tonight, you're one of His. And He ain't going to forsake you either. Amen. He's going to help us when we have no might and we don't know what to do. Realize it's okay to fear. Request of the Lord in faith. Rehearse the blessings of the Father. How many agrees with me tonight that when these trials come, that most of the time we're prone to be so overwhelmed with the bad that we forget all about the good? Is anybody with me tonight? I mean, if it's your health, if it's your family, if it's your finances, it don't matter what it is. It just seems like we're prone that way. And God wants us to remember and rehearse it. Then remember the secret of the faithful. I'll close with this tonight. We're going to have a victory over the foe. But, you know, Nebuchadnezzar, he made a decree. He made a big image of gold there in the book of Daniel. And he made a decree. He said, when you hear the sound of the sackbut and the halter, the psaltery and the flute, and there may have been some other instruments there, but when you hear the music, you're going to bow down and worship this image of gold. Y'all remember that story, right? There's three men, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, or Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. That was their Hebrew names. There was three men who said, we ain't doing it. They only bowed to God. Say amen. You could read it over there, but what I like about it is they had no might. They didn't know what to do, but I tell you, they knew what not to do. They knew not to bow down to that image of gold. And they told Nebuchadnezzar, they said, our God is able to deliver us, but if not, boy, we need to get that in our hearts. Say amen. But if not, God, you're able to take care of this situation, but if not, still not going to bow to that image of gold. Amen. And you know the story. They fired the furnace seven times hotter than it was wanting to be fired. So hot that it slew the men that threw Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego into the furnace. And go down there. Did we not throw three men into the burning fiery furnace? Lo, I see three men bound into the burning fiery furnace. Lo, I see four men loose and walking around. And the form of the fourth, if you've got the right Bible, is likened to the Son of God. Amen. I'm going to tell you something right now. Brother Larry, they had never got to experience that. If they had bowed to that image of gold. But because they wouldn't bow, God gave them the victory. Because they had their eyes on something taller than a gold statue, on something other than Nebuchadnezzar and his decree, God blessed them. And God delivered him. Amen. I'm just glad you come tonight. Listen, I appreciate you coming tonight. I hope we said something that'd be a little help. Like I said a while ago, you may not need it tonight, but put it in the bank, because you may need it before the week's over. One phone call can turn our world upside down. May God help us tonight. Let's stand and we'll be dismissed in prayer. Thank you for coming. I appreciate it so very much. Appreciate you coming this way tonight. And I pray God will just help us this week to honor him. Amen. In our hearts and in our lives. Brother Adam, if you would, brother, would you dismiss us in prayer tonight, please?